us.
We were taught to stay away from the book of Revelation. And we were taught to be afraid of it. But the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1 and the verse 3, blessed is he that readeth this book, and those that hear the words of this prophecy. John said, I was cast on an isle called Patmos. He said, I was out there for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he said, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. And I fell prostrate and I heard a voice saying, get up, John. I am he that was dead, but I'm alive forevermore. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And John, he was lifted and carried out in the spirit. But we want for you to go with us this morning as the curtain rises into the 19th chapter of the book of Revelation. Beloved disciple John, make an effort to describe the most magnificent praise that this world has ever seen. As we view this book, we see two outstanding occurrences that happened here in the 19th chapter. What is it that has prompted this crescendo of praise up before God? Hallelujah. The first is the marriage supper of the Lamb. And the second is the return to the earth of our Lord Jesus with the armies of heaven and the redeemed. And this will bring an end, O God, to the battle of Armageddon and the rule of the Antichrist and all the false prophets. But chapter 19 opens by saying, after these things, what things? The cry goes up, Babylon is called. Hallelujah. The marriage supper of the Lamb could not take place until mythical Babylon, the head of the world church, is overthrown. It is then that the glorious hallelujah call will wail up in praise before the Most High God. And John said, I heard a voice, as the voice of a great multitude, and the voice of many waters, and the voice of mighty thundering, saying, hallelujah, for the Lord omnipotent, he reigneth forever. Hallelujah. My brothers and my sisters, we can rejoice, for when this judgment happens, we will not be going through hard times and tribulation and all that, but we shall be there. For they cannot crown him Lord until we get there. And we are going to stand on that glorious day. And we are going to sing, hallelujah. Salvation and glory, honor and power unto the Lord our God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God.
Without any further ado, I present to you no other than our founder, our own beloved bishop, Reverend Delford Davis. Will you put your hands together and make him welcome in the care of the Holy Ghost, Lord. Thank you. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Gracious God, we thank you for what you have been doing in our lives and in our midst and in our nation. Pray that the Holy Spirit will minister to us through the remainder of this service. Send your gracious power upon us, and so that everyone will be touched by that power, and needs shall be supplied and met, and your name shall be honored. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please turn your Bibles with me to Galatians chapter 4. And we want to be preaching from that chapter this morning. My theme for this message: the right time will come. Touch your neighbor and tell them, the right time will come. Oh, praise God. The right time will come. Just hang in there. When I looked at some of the prophecies that were made concerning our Lord Jesus Christ, the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14 seemed as water under the bridge as time went by before its actual fulfillment, some over 700 years before it was fulfilled. Isaiah made this prophecy in chapter 7 and verse 14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Many wondered what had happened to Isaiah's prophecy as many years went by and nothing happened, but the right time will come. Genesis chapter 49 and verse 10, another prophecy concerning the Messiah's coming, would seem a nightmare to many. It says, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, for unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Many wondered what had happened to this prophecy. And when you consider that of Micah chapter 5 and verse 2, though Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting. You wonder, what was Micah speaking about as many, many years went by and nothing happened, but the right time will come. You wonder what happened to the prophecy of Psalm 69 and verse 21. What on earth were they speaking about? Listen to the words. Way back in the book of the Psalm. They gave me also gall for my meats, and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. What on earth could they be speaking of? This actually fulfilled at the time of our Lord's crucifixion. So many might have wondered what kind of nightmare these prophets are speaking about, but the right time will come. Zechariah chapter 11 verse 12, it says, and I said unto them, if ye think good, give me my price, and if not, forbear. So they weighed for my price 30 pieces of silver. What on earth could Zechariah be speaking of in those very early days?
And what were the thoughts of those who waited for many, many years and saw nothing happen concerning this prophecy? But the right time will come. Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 5. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign, and shall prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. What on earth was Jeremiah prophesying when it seemed as though he was speaking out of his own heart and not from the heart of God, as nothing transpired? Many years went by, but the right time will come. Ezekiel chapter 17 and verse 22. Thus saith the Lord God, I will also take of the highest branch, of the cedar, and will set it. It will crop off from the top of his young twigs a tender and will willing it up on the mountain, the high mountain eminently placed. What on earth was Ezekiel prophesying? Who was that highest branch that he spoke of? He spoke of none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. What were the thoughts of many in Israel when they took into consideration those prophecies? And many have lived through their generation, and they have seen other generations came along and nothing actually happened. Many might have thought these men were all false prophets, but the right time will come. What are the thoughts of your hearts concerning things that have been prophesied in your life? Things that you have read in the Word of God and believe for them, wait upon them, earnestly stay before God for them. And until today, nothing have happened with respect of those things being fulfilled in your life. What are your thoughts on this final morning of the year 2000? Some might have said, nothing will ever happen. I come to tell you, the right time will come. And that brings me to my text of Galatians chapter 5 from verse 4. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Oh, praise God. It has been said oftentimes by various ones, both Christians and non-Christians alike, that God is slow. You might have heard it. God is slow, but He is sure. And this seemed to be maybe the thoughts of those in Israel, as it is certainly the thoughts of many in my audience today, in this sanctuary and in the wider community, that indeed God is slow, even if He's sure, as many believe, but they think He is slow. I believe such statement, my brothers and sisters, is made due to a range of reasons. And among them, I submit three that I believe are reasons why that statement is made, saying God is slow. Number one, because of man's inability to properly understand divine workings, we say God is slow. Because of man's inability to properly understand divine workings, the way God does His things, we say God is slow. Secondly, as impenitence is a part of the fallen nature, so is impatience. We have become such an impenitent people, stubborn-hearted, rebellion, and so impatience is also a part of the fallen nature. And what do you mean, Pastor? I mean we just find it very difficult to wait on God to do those things that He promised to do in our lives. And thirdly, because man has been robbed, I mean because man has been robbed of longevity. That means long life, he has been robbed of it because of the fall. He now rushes on with great haste. I mean at great speed to get everything now. He rushes on to get everything now because a part of his inheritance he has been denied of it. That is many years on this earth and eternal life. Amen. Consequent to that, because he has been robbed of that, he rushes on with great haste to get everything now. Because if I do not get it now, I might not get it at all. Am I preaching to anybody here? But the right time will come. Touch your neighbor and tell them, your right time will come. Oh, praise God. And so because God works in his own time and not in our time, that statement comes about, God is slow. How on earth could we attribute that to our God who has everything under divine control? Dare you or dare me look on the eternal God and say, God, you work, but you work slow. No, God has his own timetable. Are you with me, somebody? God is not slow. Come on, somebody. And if you believe God is slow, then you believe the wrong thing about our God. He is not slow. God works in the fullness of his own time. The prophecies I gave you from the Old Testament that speaks to the coming of the Messiah and what would happen. I mean, many wondered what on earth is happening while nothing happened concerning those prophecies. Maybe they might have said God is slow. But God is not slow. He has a fullness of time. And if he were to do for you or do for me those things that we really want him to do then or now, it would not be to our benefit, because he knows better than all of us. Touch your neighbor and tell them, the right time will come. Hallelujah. Well, maybe touch you and tell you, the right time will come. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Scriptures bear it out that God is never too early. Neither is God ever too late. Neither is he a no-show God. He's always there. Jehovah Shammah says the Lord is present. Never too slow. Or never too late, or never too early. Neither is he a no-show God. Ask Daniel, and Daniel might have said to you, you think he's a no-show God? Why I hit the lion's den? Oh no, he's not a no-show God. He was there waiting on me. Ask the three Hebrew boys, and you might have said to them, your God is slow, brother. Why on earth were you thrown in the fire? Your God is a no-show God. They would tell you, shut up. He may not come when you want him, but he's always right on time. Woo! God Almighty. Glory. You see, because of the human nature, we have a problem. But God doesn't have any problem. We have a problem with time because we relate to time. God relates to eternity. Come on, somebody. 1,000 years in his sight are as but one day. He is not worried about time. He knows what he is doing. And he's perfectly positioned to take care of every one of us in earth today. Perfectly positioned, well disposed to meet our needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. But you got to wait on the right time. It will come. Are you with me? The words of the psalmist David in chapter 27 and verse 14. Oh, the sweet singer of Israel, David said to us, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Don't rush too fast. Don't run ahead of God. Don't run ahead of his scheduled time. Even if you think your time is running out, remember your time is not God's time. I don't care what the calendar is saying or what the clock on the wall is saying. God is not controlled or governed by any of those. He moves in the fullness of his own time. I would to God I had anybody here who know what I'm talking about. To wait on the right time. Woo! God Almighty, wave your hands and praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say. Touch your neighbor, tell them, wait on God. Hallelujah. And when you're waiting on God, you must wait on him for everything. Wait on him for your blessing of every sort. Wait on him for your prosperity. Wait on him for your anointing. Don't fake any anointing. Don't shake a shape that the Holy Ghost doesn't give. Don't speak a tongue that the Holy Ghost doesn't give. Don't prophesy a prophecy that the Holy Ghost doesn't give. Wait on him for your blessing. Spiritually, materially, and otherwise, be of good courage and wait. Hallelujah. And even if you think the brothers are running out in the church because they're getting married so fast, don't rush and grab anything or anyone. Wait on the Lord for your companion. God Almighty. Wait on the Lord. The psalmist continues to encourage our hearts in chapter 62, verses 5 and 6. He says, my soul, wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. Come on, somebody. I wait on God. My soul waits only upon God. If many persons were waiting on God, some of the dilemma we find ourselves in, we would never get in them. Oh, you're not with me. Some of the wrong choices we make in life, we would never have made those choices. Some of the unwise decisions we make, we would never have made those decisions. Some of the unwise business deal that we entered into, we would not have entered into those deals. Even some of those persons who you throw your money with as a banker and a partner, if you were waiting on God, you would not let that crook be your banker. You'd have saved your money in your mattress or your pillow or a tread bag and you'd be better off. But we are rushing so much because time seems to be running out. Honey, time's not running out where I am concerned. I am on an assignment. Come on, somebody. My time is in his hands. And he orders it. Our steps must be ordered in his words. Lift your hand and say, order my steps. Oh God Almighty. I shall not be moved. So I come to tell you, having laid the foundation from the prophecies that seemed as water under the bridge, from the prophecies that seem as though nothing would ever happen. And I bring you to what Paul said, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son. So why God took so long? He did not take long. He came at the right time. But look at the many tragedies that struck before the Lord Jesus Christ came and established his ministry and salvation to the lost and everybody. Look at the many atrocities that happened. They were a part of God's plan. We are still struggling with our inability to understand divine workings. Our inability to understand why God permits certain things to happen. He is God. Come on, somebody. But the right time will come. I don't know what you've been waiting on. Some of you waited for the 365 days of the year 2000. And 1999 and 98 and 97 and 96 and way back to the 80s and 70s, you have been trusting God for certain things in your life, and until now it has not happened. What do I tell you to do? Give up. Ain't no giving up. I got to go on because I believe God has it under control. Hallelujah. Let me tell you one thing. You will not pull any more preaching out of me than I feel like preaching this morning. So you keep pulling. You're not pulling one drop out of me than I given out here this morning. Come on, somebody. It is not by choice, but I'll have to preach the second service and preach tonight again. Not by choice. Amen. So hold on, my brother. Hold on, my sister. It would seem as though there is no light coming down your tunnel. But I come to tell you, when the fullness of God's time has come, a glorious light is going to hit your dark tunnel. Woo! God Almighty. And you are going to say, oh Jesus, I never knew that you even remembered me. I never knew that you heard my prayer. But I thank you because you turned up right on time. Oh, glory. When the fullness of the time came, he found a little virgin girl. And not even virgin womb could not prevent a child from coming forth. God Almighty. Oh, you're not getting my message here. Not even virgin womb could not prevent the birth of a child. If God has to do a new thing, he will do it. If he has to perform supernatural miracle, he will do it. Talk to me, somebody. If he got to work against the laws of nature, the laws of health, the laws of physics or science or mathematics, whatever law he has to work against to fulfill his purpose in your life, honey, he is ready, 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 ready to do it. Oh, God Almighty. Woo! That's why Simon had no problem when he saw the Lord walking on the water and said, God, if it's you out there, just tell me come. Jesus said, yes, Simon, it is I. Simon had no problem to step on water because he knows the God whom he serves. Nothing can stop him when the right time. Oh God, somebody lift your hands and praise him. Touch your neighbor, tell him it's coming. The right time is coming. Isaiah encouraged our hearts also in chapter 40 and verse 31. Listen what he says. He says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not weary. They shall walk and not faint. It is for those who wait upon the Lord. Touch your neighbor. Tell them, I don't know what you plan to do, but I plan to wait on the Lord. Come on, tell them again. I don't know what your plans are, but my plan is to wait on the Lord. My plan is to run and not weary. My plan is to walk and not faint. I'm not preparing to faint and weary, so I'm going to wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Come on, somebody. God set out to create and to furnish the universe. And as mighty and as powerful as God is, God, who could have done it by one word, could have done it instantaneously, in a moment's time. But he did not do it that way. He did it over a period of time. Are you with me? He did it over a period of time, giving us an example. What doesn't happen today doesn't mean it will never happen. It only means that the time is not right. Are you not with me? Rain doesn't fall today doesn't mean that rain will never fall again. Keep your pan handy. Fix your roof, because rain will fall again. There's an appointed time for things to happen. That is in your life and in my life. Lift your hand and say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So God will not do everything for us all at once. He has a fullness of time, which is the right time. Your time, my time, our time, and no one can stop it. Aren't you happy about that? I heard a gentleman made a statement yesterday. He said, why should it take us a whole lot of faith to believe in a God who has never failed? Come on, somebody. It should take a lot of faith to believe in persons who have failed ever so often. Success rate and failure rate. But believe me, when I heard the statement, I said, my God, look at this. It should not take any much faith to believe a God who has never, ever failed. His track record is one of success every step of the way. Backside of the desert, success. Egypt, success. Canaan, success. Wilderness, success. Lion's den, success. Fiery furnace, success. Anywhere you take him, success. Shouldn't take much to just throw everything on him. Oh, you're not getting this. He will not do everything all at once. You got to wait on him. Genesis 3:15, God says, I'm going to send you a seed. And after man's failure and man's fall, God promised that seed who would become the Savior. It took many, many years and many periods went by and nothing happened. And many wondered, the 400 silence here before, amen, between Malachi and Matthew, some might have wondered, what happened to God's promise? Like some of you are wondering here this morning. What has happened to God's promises concerning me? Not one thing on earth has happened to them. It's just that the fullness of time for your life concerning that situation has not yet come. So what do I do, Pastor? Wait on the fullness of time. Come on, somebody. If you're getting this message, wave your hands and give him praise. Hallelujah. But in Luke chapter 1, let's get to the message. Amen. And preach a little about this. When the fullness of time came, God found a virgin in Luke chapter 1. Amen. And from verse 26, we find these words. Luke chapter 1 and verse 26, God found a little girl there. It says, and in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin exposed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of greeting, what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God, and behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? Mary, the fullness of time has come. Nothing can stop it. Whether you have a man, yes or no, nothing can stop it. Whether you're a virgin, yes or no, nothing can stop it. The fullness of time has come. Some of you waiting on opportunities in life, and you think people hold you down. Well, I'm sorry for those of you who are so weak, especially Christians, that you have allowed people to hold you down. Come on, somebody. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And when the fullness of your time comes, nobody are not supposed to hold you down. As a matter of fact, they can't hold you down. The God in you is bigger than every other power, bigger than D. Lawrence, bigger than Hopia, bigger than bad mind, bigger than sorcery, bigger than any principality. Nothing can hold you down when the fullness of time comes. Oh, glory. Somebody lift your hands and praise God in the house. Well, I would have been better off, but because of so and so. Oh, poor you. What you need is what Mary had. And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. What you need is the power of the Highest to overshadow you. Yes, I'm overshadowed by his boundless love. And I have protection from my Lord above. Jesus walks beside me every passing day. And I know he'll guide me. Lift your hand and say, I know he'll guide me all the way. Come on, somebody, praise God here. When the power of the Highest overshadowed Mary, what has never ever happened before happened. Come on, somebody. I'm here to tell you, when the right time has come for you and the power of the Highest overshadows you, wherever you are, what has never happened before, the job you think you could never get, you'll get that job. The house you think you could never afford, you'll get that house. The car you think you could never buy, God gives it to you. Amen, somebody. The husband or wife you think you'd never get, God brings them to you, because the power of the Highest has overshadowed you, and things will happen. Lift your hand and say, overshadow me, Holy Ghost. God Almighty, don't let me preach here, but what some people are waiting on, it's for an evangelist to lay hands on them. It's for somebody to prophesy over them. It's for somebody to call them out. Listen to me. What you need is the power of the Highest to overshadow.
to you in your kitchen, in your bathroom, in your living room, in your bedroom, in the church, on the bus, anywhere you are. If the power of the highest overshadow you, some things are going to happen. Oh God Almighty. Oh, if somebody would praise the King of Heaven, then the power would fall on you right now. Glory! And the right time will bring about everything that is supposed to happen in your life. God Almighty. Mary never slept with a man. Never ever slept with a man prior to all of this. But all of a sudden, after the overshadowing of the power of the highest, she felt something happened on the inside. Come on, somebody. A divine impregnation took place. Oh, the sperma. The sperma, the Greek word sperma, which is a word of God, entered into her womb, and conception took place, and the prophecy began to be fulfilled. And in a moment's time, everybody would see that what was said in Genesis 49:10, what was said in Micah 5:2, what was said in Isaiah 7:14, what was said in Ezekiel 23:9, all of these would come to pass, and all nations will see that what God said He will do, He will certainly do. God Almighty, tell somebody, you haven't seen the best of me as yet. Let's go a little further. Tell them, you might have seen the bad side of me, honey, but the best is yet to come. I'm just waiting on the fullness of time. I'm getting in line. Tell them, I'm getting in line. I'm getting in line. I'm getting in line. Hundreds are ahead of me, but I'm going to stay in my place. I'm going to stay right where God has placed me. And in the fullness of time, you're going to see the real me, the righteous me, the holy me, the anointed me, the power pack me, come forth in the fullness. My God, if you praise Him in this house, you're going to see the glory of God. You're going to see the seed come forth. Woo! So don't write me off. Don't mark me off. My car may break down sometimes, and my muffler give bad smoke sometimes, but I got a brand new engine coming. The body may be old, the body may be tattered, but I got a brand new engine coming, honey. Lord, I feel like preaching, but let me not preach. I got a brand new engine coming, a brand new turbo coming in my soul. It's coming like a dynamite. It's coming with power. God Almighty, woo! Give Him praise. Give Him praise. Give Him praise. Give Him glory. Tell that devil, I got a brand new engine coming. Hallelujah. Sit down, let me preach for 5 more minutes. Because the devil is a liar. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. I feel it. I know it.
Woo!
Sometimes ago, I was told about a man. I said it before right here. Who bought a brand new car. Crisp. Straight from the factory. And he thought he could take on everybody on the road. Could take on everything on four wheels. So he headed out one day and he knew a man with an old vehicle, old model stuff. And the guy said, I can give you a challenge. Take me on. He said, oh no, it'll be a waste of time to take you on. You don't see what I have. Brand new, crisp. The old guy said, give me a try. Come on. And they gathered everybody, spectators from all over the place. This is a big showdown. He called this guy with his crisp, brand new stuff. Said, I'm going to blow you out of the way. And they all gathered. And they drew up beside each other. And when the time came for the stretch, and when they took off, the guy with his crisp, brand new stuff, he took off like a shot out of a gun. And everybody said, yay, that's it. The guy with the older stuff, he took a little time to get going hot. But as soon as he get warmed up and he hit the road, and the guy that was flying like a shot out of a gun, he noticed that his whole stuff just flew past him, and he thought he was reversing as fast as he was going. He thought he was in a reverse. When the guy with the old stuff reached a couple of miles way down, he stopped. The guy with the brand new stuff finally caught up with him, and he stopped also. And he said, man, you got to tell me about the secret. The guy with the whole stuff said, you look on the external. You look on the whole beaten up bumper and the fender. But he flew the bonnet. He lifted up the wood. And he said, look at this. This is what matters. This is not what matters. Oh God Almighty. This is what matters. Hallelujah. I don't care how you feel. I don't care how old you are, honey. Get ready for a brand new engine. It's not coming from Mercedes. It's not coming from BMW. It's not coming from Jaguar. It's not coming from Mitsubishi. It is coming from the Holy Ghost. He's going to drop something in your soul. And you say like Jeremiah, I feel like the fire shut up in my bone. I feel like walking, talking, running, singing and shouting because the right time has come. Oh, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Slap your neighbor and tell him, wait on the right time. Wait on your time. Wait on God. Woo! Some of you have been waiting on the manifestation of God's power in your life. You've been waiting on it. I come to tell you that you are in line. And some of you might not know it, but you are next in line. Oh God Almighty. The next hand to touch you will not be the hands of the pastor. The next hand to touch you will be the hand of His Majesty. Oh my God Almighty. Hallelujah. The next voice you hear in your ears will be the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the next street you step on will not be defeat and sorrow and misery. It will be Victory Avenue. Victory Avenue. Victory Avenue. Because the right time has come. Hallelujah. I say to those who have been waiting on the Lord for the fulfillment of a prophecy in your life, it has been prophesied long time ago what God is going to do in your life and do for you. And like Micah's prophecy, like Isaiah's prophecy, like the prediction of Genesis, you have seen nothing. And many years have come and gone. Thank God you are still in the church. Because it's not going to be fulfilled outside there. The Lord shall bless you out of Zion. So you got to stay in Zion. And I come to tell you that only a matter of time. It's going to be fulfilled. Hallelujah. This message is not a makeup story. It is one that came from the heart of God. God gave it to me to tell every one of you here this morning in this first service that the right time will come. Don't be discouraged because of that man who is doing 300 miles down the highway. God is going to equip you, and you're going to be able to run through every troop and leap over every wall, because your right time would have come. Give him praise, give him praise. I come to tell those who have been waiting on a miracle in your life, healing for your body, deliverance in your home, in your family, and complete deliverance. I come to tell you this morning, in the fullness of God's time, it will come. Give him praise. Don't think that God is slow. He's not slow. Neither is he a no-show God. He shows up all the time. Are you hearing me, somebody? Activities are always going on where God is concerned. He is never a passive God. He is always an active God. He is never a silent God. He is always doing something. Activities are going on, but they are happening in the darkness of divine hidings. So, because of our inability to fully comprehend divine workings, it would seem as though not one thing is happening. Just touch your neighbor very softly and whisper in their ears and tell them, things are happening. Tell them, I don't want anybody to hear what I'm telling you, but whisper it and tell them, things are happening. Things are happening in the darkness of divine hidings. Activities are going on. The Holy Ghost is working. Are you with me, somebody? Things are happening. Glory. Wave your hands and give him thanks and praise. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Woo! Ask Brother Job. Job said things are happening. I go backward, I can't find him. I go forward, I still can't find him. I go in some secret corners, I can't perceive him. But Job said, nevertheless, he knows the way that I take. And Job said, all my appointed time. God Almighty. Job knew that there was an appointed time. So all the days of my appointed time will I wait. Until the undertaker comes. Is that what he said? I'll wait until my change come. Criticize me as much as you want to. Backbite me as much as you want to. Tear me down as much as you want to. And even some of you that shout at me and dance with me and laugh with me, when you go out of here, you make me stew peas, you make me curry goat, you make me roast chicken, you make me roast duck, you make me stew pork, you make me all kind of meat, and you heat me raw, you heat me live, you heat me dead, you heat me alive. But do what you want to do, honey. All my appointed time, I'm just waiting until change come. You're gonna see me. Amen. You're going to see me in the glory of the anointed of God. You may not like it, but you got to bite it. Those who don't like it, bite it. But when the right time comes, when the change comes, the devil's got to watch you go. The gates of hell cannot prevail. Because if God be for us, if God be for you, if God be for me, tell me who can be against me? If God is in your corner, if God is at your house, if God is in your kitchen, if God walks with you, if God talks with you, tell me who. Oh my God Almighty! Somebody shout and praise Him. Woo! Tell your neighbor, not even you can stop me. Not even you, honey. I don't care how big you are, how strong you are, how mighty you are. When the power of the highest overshadow me. God, I feel the Holy Ghost in my head. I want to preach in this house. When the power of the highest overshadow me, the gates of hell shall not prevail. Lift your hand and say yes. Say yes. Call His name. Woo! Let me stop. I wait till my change. The fullness of time. God sent His Son. Herod tried to stop Him. Sanhedrin councils tried to stop Him. All hell lifted up its heels against Him. But up on this rock, up on this Petra, will I build my ecclesia, and the gates of Gehenna, Sheol, shall not prevail against the church. Lift your hand and say, I am on the rock. I am on the rock. I am in the rock. And the gates of hell shall not prevail. Hallelujah. Stand, everybody. David said, I trust in thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my God. My times are in thine hand. So I am waiting on the fullness of your time in my life. Lift your hands on, begin to worship Him, everybody. Hallelujah. 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 Woo! My God Almighty. Hallelujah. My God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God, you don't need the power of the highest up on you right now. Begin to worship Him. And while we worship Him, I want every unsaved and every backslider to begin to make your way down to this altar right now. Come from everywhere. I know the audience is packed, but make your way out and come to Jesus. Let Him fulfill in your life that which has been spoken by the Holy Ghost concerning you. You are not destined for a curse. You are destined for a blessing. You are not destined for failure. You are destined for success. You are not destined for defeat. You are destined for victory. Come turn it over to Jesus. And let Him fix it for you, oh God Almighty. Come give it all to Him. He's going to fix it for somebody here this morning. I don't care what devils have told you. There's a God in your midst. There's a God who is standing by. All of my unsaved friends, backsliders. And if you're a defeated believer, it's time to walk in victory. Nobody should be ending this year on a note of defeat. A couple hours time, we take you into the year 2001. By the help of God, we want to take you in on high spirits, on wings of a snow white dove. My God, He wants to send this pure sweet love. Come on down, everybody, come on down. You need a touch of the Master's hand. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I feel somebody else is still holding out on God. Come right now. This is your hour for deliverance. This is your hour for a miracle. God is ready. The Holy Ghost is ready. The church is ready. Bow your heads at the altar, please. Close your eyes. Get ready to make some spiritual contact. Oh, Jesus, say, come.
Every day.
everybody in the house pray. Pastor, I don't know how to pray. Well, tell God what is on your heart. That's how you pray. That's how you pray. Tell God where you are, what's on your heart, your cares, your concerns, your need, your sorrows. Don't tell him of the victories, because that's all right. He wants the minister. Tell him where you're weak, where you feel most vulnerable. Tell him the besetting sin that has been hindering you from making a full commitment to him. Tell him that's how you pray. So everybody can pray. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Roma mama setere be kushetia. Rosa te moruna setie. Oh, Roma sete koroma nisata. Oh, my God, the Holy Ghost is ministering to somebody. Save them, Lord. Jesus. Bring them into the fullness of the Spirit. Oh, God. Not for 2001. Oh, no. They cannot enter 2001. If you take us there as they are, please save them. Please save them. Please wash them in your precious blood. Apply the healing stream. Oh, Jesus. A young man's heart is reaching out for you, Lord. God, a woman's life is in misery and turmoil. A family is in disarray. Oh, God. Somebody's health is failing them fast. And the physicians can't help. They need you, oh, thou great physician. Ronama sete Yahoo. Oh, yes. You're promising your word that while we call you here, and while we speak your answer, please, Lord, hear a mother's plea. Oh, hear a child's supplication. Feel the heartbeat of this congregation right now. So people, so needs. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes. Ronama seketia. Reveal your fullness to them, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Standing somewhere in the shadow, you'll find Jesus. He's the Holy One who cares and understands.
Somewhere,
lift your hands, everybody. Worship God. Worship God.
And you know him
by the name. Prince in his hand. Call his name now, everybody. Jesus.
Oh.
Jesus. Everybody lift your right hand and pray this prayer after me. Close your eyes and say after me, Lord Jesus, I thank you for sparing my life to see the final moments of the year 2000. Lord, many things went wrong during the year, but you've been a good God. I ask you now to let your Holy Spirit rest upon my life. And if you tarry and I see the year 2001, I want to enter into that year with your blessing. I cannot enter as a sinner. I cannot enter as a backslider. I cannot enter as a defeated Christian. I do not want to enter with sickness in my body, with sorrow in my life. So I ask you, Lord, to let your anointing rest upon me now. Rest upon me, anointing. Bring me deliverance. Bring me a miracle. And right now, I believe by faith that your hand is on my life. And I shall leave this service this morning charged with your anointing, with a new commitment to serve you in spirit and in truth. Thank you for hearing my prayer. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now lift up your other hands and everybody begin to praise him. Both of your hands, open your mouth. Come on, church, praise God. Some of you not saying anything. Open your mouth and make noise, praise him. Make a joyful noise, let your voice be heard. Yay! Rusha Baba Sendia. You lying devil, take your hands up. Never take your hands up. Never take your hands up. Take your hands up. Bo-bo-bo-bo, shake it higher. Take your hands off, devil! Go! Go, go, go! The power of God be upon you! The power of God be upon you! The power of God be upon you! You! Whoa! Hey! God Almighty, look at the Holy Ghost! Look at the Holy Ghost! Look at the Holy Ghost! Healing, delivering, setting people free. Amen. Amen. Praise God. How many of you have made a commitment to Jesus Christ this morning? From today you want to serve God. Lift up your hand, let me see. You want to serve God. You can't continue the way you are. You want to serve him. Lift them up high. Come on, raise them high. Somebody praise God. All right. Now, the church is here. And it is here to serve you. If you come, you make yourself available, we are here to serve you. If you leave and you go back, and you do not come, we can't serve you the way we really want to serve. Those of you who have raised your hand, we would not want to take you into counseling. Talk to you a little more about God's plan for your life, because some of you don't know it as yet. Oh no, you don't. You're living outside of that. So we'd want to take you into counseling and show you God's plan for your life. We would want to encourage you to make a full commitment by following the Lord in water baptism. We'd want to take you into new members class and teach you the scriptures. We'd want to lead you into the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We'd want to teach you the way of holiness and hope that you'll apply yourself to it. And when all of those are finished and Jesus called for you, you would be ready to meet with him in eternity. That's what we want to do. All of those.
not just to preach to you and pray for you and leave you and you're going back. We want to do a complete work. Are you with me?
Bow down and worship Him. Worship Him. Oh, worship Him. Bow down and worship Him.